scent of a woman playing, and you're wearing glasses now, sunglasses. You wore glasses as a blind man, right? Oh, no, you didn't. You had them off a lot, too.
Yeah, I had them off a lot. No, I didn't wear sunglasses much.
When you're playing a blind person,
yeah,
and you had to do that scene of the dance,
yeah,
what do you see?
It's the oddest thing. You don't see anything.
What do you mean?
Because you don't focus your eyes. And what happens is you just go into a state. As a matter of fact, I had an eye injury during the shooting of the film because I fell into a bush. And the worst kind of eye injury is when plant life gets into your cornea. It's stuck in my cornea. But as I was falling, my eyes weren't focusing and the thing went in my eye. So it's also dangerous to do that.
So you're saying you were blind during that movie?
Yeah. And you know what's so interesting is because I asked my little daughter at the time, she was at that time about 3, and I said to her, Julie, could you show me, if you were doing something, how do you do a blind person? She was spot on. She was just perfect. I said, bam. No work, no preparation, no nothing. She just did it. So, you know, it's, I didn't, you know, I did a variation on that theme, but.
Was it difficult?
No, it wasn't. Well, having having an affliction or something, it's just like having an accent. It gives an actor something to feed into. It feeds you. It serves you as an actor.
How'd you come up with hoo-ha?
Well, I had this guy who was teaching me how to assemble and disassemble a .45 blind. And we would spend
countless... You did that yourself back then?
Yeah. And I would spend hours just learning how to take it on him. And he was then, he was a real lieutenant, one of the guys, I don't know what his rank was. And one time I did it right, and he went, hoo-ah, hoo-ah,
hoo-ah.
I said, what's that? And he would do it every time I did something right. And it's an expression used in the army. So I thought, let me, and it worked its way into the part.
That was a hell of a movie. Sea of Love.
Sea of Love.
That sex scene.
Yeah.
All right.
I thought you'd never ask, Larry.
You and Ellen Barkin, one of the sexiest scenes ever filmed.
Well.
I don't want to bring up names. Marcello Mastroianni.
That's because I had all my clothes on.
Marcello Mastroianni told me that sex scenes are the hardest thing to do because it's hard to be sexy when there's 43 cameramen around.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that had a lot to do with Harold Becker's direction because he had orchestrated that in such a way that all you had to do is show up. And he had just moved it in different ways. Well, yeah, it's not the hardest thing in the world to kiss Ellen Barkin, you know, I mean, that you do. But at the same time, if it's orchestrated, if it has a purpose, if it's made to do something and it's orchestrated, literally planned and worked out, moment by moment, step by step, and that's what Harold Becker did. He knew what he wanted. He knew how to get out of it this quality, this sexual...
Did you get excited?
Well, you know,
No, I mean, do you or don't you?
I mean, I'm excited now. I'm always excited.
You know? Yeah, you're kind of passionate. Godfather, Serpico, Dog Day Afternoon, Scarface.
I buried those cockroaches!
It's like you don't talk much when you're doing something like that afterward. You're not in, you know, you've it's almost tantamount to being a fighter.
I'm gonna get him!
Like a boxer, right, who's in the ring.
Inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished.
He doesn't fight much after, you know, he doesn't go out and get into a brawl in a bar.
See? Because this is how we keep score, boobie.
Are you easily directed?
Well, yeah, kind of in a way, if the director knows what they want, yeah. Sure, I kind of like, as Sidney Lumet once said, director directs. He says, go here, you go there, you go there, you go here.
Okay, you follow it well. But have you disagreed?
Well, I don't know if I follow it. Well, look, with a guy like Lumet, he tells you, this is where you go when you come in the bank. You go here, you go there, you go around there, you do that, you do this, and you know what? You're in a bank robbery. You don't even know how, you don't have to act. You're just doing what he tells you and you're there. There's the bank robbery. That's genius. So when you work with a genius, that's what you, you know, that's good. That doesn't happen often, but sometimes you get lucky.
One of the great movies ever made, you made so many of the great movies ever made. Wow. It was Dog Day Afternoon.
Dog Day, yeah, it was great.
And that actor you worked with.
Oh, John Cassell, oh yeah.
He was a great actor.
He was a great, great artist.
When he was Fredo, was that, he had to play such a weak character, yet the oldest brother.
Yeah.
That was quite a job he did. Oh, yeah. Yet you were sympathetic to him.
Yeah, yeah. I tell you, yeah, no, nobody liked John. I mean, he could do it. How about the guy in Dog Day?
Yeah, well, in that character, yeah.
I mean,
you were two gay guys robbing a bank, right?
Well, that's what he wasn't. And remember when that moment comes?
Well, he wasn't. You were gay.
I was gay. Well, I was AC/DC. So, and so, this moment where they say two gay robbers in the bank, and John's character says, "I'm not gay.
I'm not a homosexual."
And John Cassell says to Sidney Lumet, "Why do I say I'm gay? Why do I say I'm not gay?" And Sidney looked at him as well, you know, they start talking. Knowing John, I know this is gonna go on for a while, right? Because I know John, I work with him. And Sidney starts to satisfy his question, you know, and then, but it won't get satisfied. And it goes on. But I knew enough to go off to the side and sort of practice whatever I was practicing.
Say I'm not gay?
Well, he didn't understand why he said it. And then Sidney, finally, you hear Sidney say, "You're saying it because it's in the script and I'm telling you to say it." And he said, "Oh, you should have told me that in the first place."
That was a hell of a movie.
Yeah. But the thing about movies that's so interesting is that you can, and I've heard Dustin Hoffman talk like this, is you can suddenly do something in a movie that's absolutely spontaneous and right there. Like in Dog Day, when I was going to say Attica, right?
Attica! Attica!
Well, I have to go out there and talk to a mob. And this guy, Bert Harris, a great AD, assistant director of Sidney Lumet, comes up to me and says, "Why don't you say Attica? Just say Attica." Because it just had happened when they went into the prison and killed all those all those prisoners. And it was really in the air, hot and heavy in the air. And I just got it. I thought, okay. And I went out there and said, you know, "Attica." And the crowd just went, "Attica," you know. And they went, "Attica." I said, "Attica." And it was like this, you know, reciprocal thing. And it just came back and forth. And before we knew it, we were in the zone together, you know.
Working with De Niro.
Oh, my. Bobby. Well, Bob is...
The two of you are like...
But Bob
but he don't do. But he doesn't do theater.
No, he doesn't. You know, Bob is a kind of artist who has always been connected to movies. That's his art form. Mm-hmm. That's where he expresses himself. And it's a different kind of thing. He's. There are actors who find their art through film. A lot of them today, most of them today.
And now that we've been face to face, if I'm there and I gotta put you away, I won't like it. But I'll tell you, if it's between you and some poor bastard whose wife you're gonna turn into a widow, brother, you are going down.
Tonight on 360 Breaking News, President Obama striking a deal with Republicans to extend the Bush tax cuts even for the richest Americans. Candidate Obama promised to repeal those very tax cuts over and over again. So why did he change his mind? Why did he break with liberals in his own party? We're keeping them honest. Then a sad turn in Elizabeth Edwards' battle with cancer tonight. Her doctors say that further treatment would be unproductive and futile. She's stopping treatment. She's at home with ex-husband John Edwards, their kids in North Carolina. We'll talk about the latest development with Dr. Sanjay Gupta and Jessica Yellen. Those stories and new evidence that Mexico's brutal drug cartels may be recruiting teenage hitmen. You'll meet a 14-year-old boy who says he has killed repeatedly for drug traffickers. All that and more at the top of the hour. Now back to Larry King.
Oh,
defeat alcoholism?
Well, I didn't defeat it. One doesn't look at it that way.
How long are you sober?
All I could say is I'm never sober. I don't want to be sober. But I have to say, I don't drink. But a part of being involved in alcohol and the way of that life and all, which is today, it's extremely interesting to see the way it's dealt with today, mainly because of the DUIs, because of drunk driving, because that's, that's just not, that's not permissible. It's just, but aside from that, people drink and, you know, it's a different world today because of the scrutiny and the attention being paid to this. In my day, it was all part of being, as they used to say to Laurence Olivier, Sir Laurence Olivier, what's your favorite part of acting? He'd say, the drink after the show. That was his favorite part. So it was all part of a world. And then when it started to replace, when the cart was in front of the horse, and it sort of replaced the work and all other parts, I was reluctant to stop, but my great friend Charlie Lawton, who I've talked about so many times.
Not the actor, but the same name.
The same name. He was a real influence over me because he was my mentor, my closest friend. Really begged me to stop for a while, just to take a look at it and ask me if I would, because he had stopped for about a year and I was continuing, and he was quite worried about me. It was during one of those episodes of drinking in London that I turned down Dog Day. I actually turned it down. I said, I don't want to go into a bank or rob a bank and do all that stuff. I was talking like this. And I actually turned it down after I had said yes. And I was very lucky I had someone like Marty Bregman and Sidney Lumet around.
Made you do it.
Well, they didn't just make me do it. They understood I wasn't going to do it. I quit. And they got somebody else. And during the course of this time, Bregman was on me. I said, Marty, I don't want to do this. He said, if you stop drinking for a while, could you just stop for a while? I said, okay, for a while, and read the script. I said, okay. He said, no, I mean it. Just don't drink for a while. So I didn't drink for a couple of days, and I read the script. It was clear. I said, why am I not doing this? I should be doing this. And I called him. I said, you know, Marty, you're right. This is a great script. He said, okay, talk to you later. Boom. And he got on it. And he somehow wangled and wiggled as only he can, and he knows how to do it. And I was very lucky I had him there.
But how did but you Lamette stop drinking? How did you stop drinking?
I didn't just stop dead on. It's a gradation. You know, you gradate from one stage to another, and then it takes a while to even, you know, like, to, as they often say, unscramble your brains. You know, you have a certain period of time. And then slowly I got to understand what it was, and...
Are you ever tempted?
You know, as Norman Mailer once said, why he keeps drinking, and he knows how difficult it is for him to do it, he said, I can't give it up because it would be one less way to relax. And the truth is, you know, we need our anodynes. You know that word, anodynes? Mm. We need them in life sometimes. A good warm bath can be one for you, or whatever. And, a nice glass of wine is an anodyne. You know, at the end of a day, you have something and sit back, drink it, enjoy it.
Are you tempted?
As we speak, I am. What's in here? No, I'm not. I'm not. It's been a long time, so I don't see the need for it. I don't think about it.
Could you ever act while drunk?
No, I didn't like that, and I've done it.
You did?
And I did it with John Cassell on stage.